SSH keygen-t ED25519. I know one day you'll come back to this video wanting that exact command, so here it is. And for the rest of you, we'll cover the instructions for creating SSH keys later on in this video. But we first need to talk about authentication. The typical way you're used to securely authenticating with websites on the internet is by using a login form. Enter your username and password, and those credentials are transmitted securely to a remote server via HTTPS. Once that server receives your credentials, it then compares them to the ones it has on file, and if they match, you're in. Though this authentication pattern is commonplace, in the professional software development world, it's not preferred. Transmitting that secret password back and forth increases the chances of intercepting it in transit. Plus, storing a lot of secret information in bulk on a website's servers makes them juicy targets for hackers. Not to mention that human-related factors play a role, like reused and memorable passwords. Fortunately, there is another method that most professional software developers use, and that method is called SSH. SSH provides better security and data integrity than a username and password, and it only requires a one-time setup process to authenticate any future connection. In this video, we'll learn how it works and how to generate your own set of secure SSH keys on Windows, Mac, and Linux machines. Let's get started. SSH is typically used for things like connecting to cloud development servers or remote Git repositories. So let's just say I have a Git repository here hosted on a cloud server. This typically means that the repository is uploaded to a Git hosting service such as GitHub or GitLab, or maybe just some private server somewhere on the internet. So if I want to connect to that hosting service, I need a way to securely prove it's me. That's what we call authentication. To do this with SSH, I'd need to first generate what's called an SSH key on my personal computer. In reality, this SSH key is actually a pair of two keys, a private key and a public key. These two keys work together to establish secure connections between two computers. As the name suggests, you want to keep that private key to yourself and never share it with anyone. However, its public key counterpart is free to be openly shared with the world. In this case, I'd simply give a copy of my public key to my Git hosting service. Public and private keys are actually just plain text files stored on your computer. Those files each contain a long string of characters and numbers that are generated by an encryption algorithm. So when I say share your public key, what you're actually doing is sharing that string of characters and numbers contained within the public key file. The hosting service stores my public key, and anytime data needs to be exchanged, a cryptographic handshake will occur behind the scenes to verify your identity. The server will generate what's called a challenge using the public key. Think a really hard math problem that's impossible to solve without the private key. Once it sends that challenge, the private key is used to solve the problem. Then the solution is transmitted back to the server. This proves that the user was indeed in possession of the private key counterpart to the public key that generated the challenge in the first place. This is called a challenge response authentication, and I'll leave more information about that in the description. And that's it, you're securely connected. Since this example was about remote Git repositories, you can start cloning, pushing, and pulling your Git changes with that remote repository. And if you want to learn more about that or pretty much any other Git operation using motion graphics similar to the ones in this video, you know where to look. As you can see, SSH is pretty convenient and inherently more secure than usernames and passwords. The only thing you need to get started is your own set of private and public keys. So let's discuss how you can generate your own. The good news is the instructions for doing this are the same whether you're on a Windows, Mac, or Linux machine. Simply start by pulling up a terminal or command prompt window. In macOS, you can use Spotlight Search to find the terminal application, and if you're in Windows, just look for a command prompt. Now that we have our terminal open, we're going to use a utility called SSH keygen to generate our SSH key pair. The full command is just ssh-keygen-t ED25519. And that may look confusing, but all the -t flag does is tell the keygen utility to use the ED25519 algorithm to generate the keys. This algorithm is crucial to the process because it cryptographically links the two keys so that the challenge response authentication protocol can work as we discussed earlier. There are other algorithms, but this one is the most modern. All right, let's execute this command and watch the magic. SSH key pairs are actually just normal files behind the scenes, and generating these files is what the keygen utility does. After executing the command, it should prompt you to confirm the location where the keys will be stored. By default, these keys live in the hidden .ssh folder located usually in your home directory, but you're going to see the location here. So you can either change that location or confirm the default by hitting enter. Next, you'll be prompted to enter an optional passphrase for your key. A passphrase is a way to further secure the key, and if you choose to use one, you'll need to provide it anytime you want to use your private key. The reason you might want to do this is to just add an extra layer of security in the event that your personal computer becomes compromised. A passphrase ensures that even if they get access to the key file, they can't access the key within it. If you're working with sensitive data or don't trust your personal computer's physical security, feel free to enter a passphrase now. All right, and that was the last piece of input we needed to give the program. So it went ahead and generated the key. You know it worked because you'll have this funny little ASCII art on your screen. And we can also navigate to the location of these key files and just take a look for ourselves. So if we navigate there and list the contents of the directory, you'll see the two key files. ID underscore is the private key, and the corresponding file of the same name that ends in .pub is the public key. Together, these two files are your SSH key pair. And I'll actually show you the contents of these files too. Here is the public key that you'll share with the service that you're connecting to. And here is that private key that you want to keep secret and never share with anyone. Also, feel free to paste that location into the file explorer like I'm doing here on a Windows computer to access your keys. There's many ways to do it. That's it. Now that you've generated your new SSH key pair, you're all set to share it and use it for your authentication needs. Since I mostly cover Git topics on this channel, I'll leave links to some setup instructions for popular Git hosting services in the description. But SSH is not limited to Git. Feel free to use your public key anywhere SSH is accepted. Happy connecting.